good morning. We have Roxy. So again, I am Lisa French here with the Louisiana Department of Education, and I will go ahead and officially call our meeting of the Advisory Council on Student Behavior and Discipline to order. I think the first order of business, because we have a lot of new faces, we've had some transition off and some transition on in terms of new people. So I think it would be helpful if we go around the room and everyone introduce yourself, share the entity or organization that you represent, and any other information that you may want the group to know about you. So, Rob, what's up?
I'm Rob Sheriff. I was appointed nominated to be member of the committee by the Louisiana Association of Principals, Executive Director, Ms. Debbie Shum. Previously, classroom teacher, assistant principal, supervisor, child for attendance. Also worked here with the Department of Education, local discipline, child for attendance, safety and drug free schools, PBIS. And I'm presently employed as an assistant principal at John Lowry Communication Arts Family School in Florence.
I'm Mike Artigo, I'm a school psychologist in Jeff Davis Parish, and I represent the People and Placement Coordinators.
I'm sorry, you represent what?
People and Placement Coordinators.
Okay, great. Can you guys hear over there? I know the sign in here is horrible. So if you guys could just speak a little louder, please.
I'm Dawkins, I'm superintendent of schools in the Evangeline Parish. I was nominated by the Louisiana Association of School Superintendents.
Great.
I'm Anita Austin, first year principal, Emeryville STEM Academy in Emeryville Parish. And I'm also, well, not also, I'm representing the Louisiana Association of Principals.
Welcome.
My name is
Lynn
Butler. I'm actually a client at office, and I'm sitting in today with Tori Roma, who is over our public policy department, and we just couldn't make it today because he had another appointment that was scheduled, and he's in the New Orleans office.
Hi, Judy Easterly. I'm with the Louisiana Department of Health, Office of Public Health here at Development Health, and I'm here representing the Louisiana Department of Health.
Hi, I'm Tamara Keefit. I'm actually a classroom teacher first at, in Livingston Parish, and I'm a freshman. I am representing LFT, Louisiana Federation of Teachers. I'm the president of the Livingston group.
Hi, good morning. My name is Gina Womack, and I am the executive director of Families and Friends of Louisiana's Incarcerated Children.
My name is Melanie Jacobs. I'm representing the Louisiana Association of Special Education Administrators.
I am Ariel Kess. I am the School Legal Services Director from the
I am Julie Cobo, and I'm here representing Lacey and I'm here.
I'm Courtney Rowland, I'm a program manager for the Louisiana Developmental Disabilities Council, and I'll be serving as proxy today for Sean.
I'm Alan Coulter, and I'm here representing Louisiana Psychological Association.
Good morning, I'm Caroline Romer, I'm the executive director of the Louisiana Association of Public Charter Schools.
Danny Garrett, here representing the Louisiana School Board Association.
Great, okay. Just as a matter of order of business, for the proxies that are here today, thank you for attending. As a proxy, you are able to participate in discussion, but proxies are not able to vote or nominate. Yes, I'm sorry, Brad.
Okay, I'm James Brad Freedom. I represent the Child Welfare and Attendance.
Okay, so then the first order of business is we need to elect a new chair of this council, and so I will open the floor for nomination of chair. Brad.
Okay, I'd like to nominate Robert Schatz.
Okay. Robert, do you accept the nomination?
Okay.
Okay. You gave
gave out a long list of things she's done, so it just seems appropriate that that would fit right in the blank.
So I'm doing a self-nomination for myself, and we can send an email because Victor and I jumped, asking us to sound of, I think, nominated. We sent an email to volunteer co-chair.
Any other nominations?
I'm sorry, we're talking about the chair.
Correct. So then, right now, we have a current slate of two nominations. One being Robert Shaw, and Robert accepted the nomination. Then the other being co-chair by Gina Womack and Victor Jones. Victor Jones. So if those are all the nominations, yes, Brad.
I'm still not clear. You said co-chair. We're at the one at the time right now. The answer is that the chair. Right? I mean, it's two completely different things.
So, Brad has raised a concern around the one of the current nominations on the floor, and that is for two individuals to co-chair. So they will both serve as chair, which is the position that we are currently discussing. But there will be two, which is why it is designated co-chair. Are there any concerns with a nomination of two individuals to serve as co-chair?
Does the legislation prohibit that?
It doesn't say
that. Does it say? Okay, so, yes, ma'am.
I'm so sorry.
That's okay.
If we're going to talk about two positions, chair and co-chair, I would totally have the co-chair.
So let me offer a point of clarification. My interpretation, Gina, of what you have put on the floor is not a chair and a co-chair, but it is two individuals in the capacity of chair. So there will be two chairs serving as co-chairs.
Can I ask Gina why you want that structure? I'm not opposing that, but give some thought over that.
Well, this is something that Victor and I talked about to do it together if, you know, and
somebody can be here.
Right, and we could actually do whatever it cares to together, right?
This great lawyer, Ruth, generally in a public body, you'll have a chair and a vice chair, so that the chair is not there, the vice chair would be able to serve in that capacity. In a public body with co-chairs, I'm not exactly sure who would be the chair during the meeting. And that could become, not that y'all would ever disagree, but there could be a circumstance where they disagree. And I think because we're a public body, it would put us in a very difficult position. So I think it would be more appropriate for us to do a chair, vice chair, so that you would have that backup in case someone couldn't be. But that's just my 2 cents.
Yes.
Clearly, we could have used the vice chair this year.
Yes.
So I think that's, we should learn from our history.
I'm sorry,
was
that
right?
Two different.
Yeah, and that'd be.
Right. What Danny has put on the table, yes, is different than what Gina and Victor are putting on the table. Are there any comments to what Danny and Alan have shared?
Is that a motion that we create the position of vice chair? Is that appropriate? Is that what's happening? Or are we just challenging the proposed co-chair?
I think the way I heard it from Danny, you were just making a comment. I didn't hear a motion.
No, I was just making a comment because
right.
The only item, I mean, we're actually still on an agenda item, which
correct.
Is the nomination of people for chair.
Chair, correct. Right. So this is a discussion of that nomination. Yeah. Yes.
Just to clarify, you're accepting the legislative candidate having a co-chair.
Correct.
So if they
So, Brad?
I will make a motion right now that we will elect a chair. This is a motion on the table, a chair.
That's the agenda.
Right.
You don't need to make a motion, right?
So let's vote on a chair.
So we're discussing right now. So before we get to vote, we have to give everyone on this council an opportunity to give comment.
I made a motion.
But there's
So there's going to be a second and then a discussion.
I guess technically it would be a substitute motion. Instead of a motion to elect a chair, it would be a motion to restrict the election to just a chair as opposed to a co-chair. Because we could make that decision and then move forward from there.
Regina just made a nomination.
Right.
Maybe the best thing to do is she could change her nomination.
I could too. And I would just nominate myself as chair. It does not mean
So now we have two nominations for the position of chair. Are there any other nominations? So we will close nominations and we will vote on the two individuals that have been nominated. Yes, we're going to do a voice vote. Yeah, and so the first nomination was Robert Schaff, and so we're going to do a voice vote. So if you want to talk, you call.
Bless you. Okay, so Robert was nominated first, so we're going to go around the room. If you're voting for Robert, I'm going to call Robert first. If they say yes, then we'll go around with Regina. So this is for Robert. If you vote for Robert, say yes. If you're not, say no. So for Robert, Dr. Austin?
Yes.
Dr. Coulter?
Yes.
Tamara Cupid?
No.
Gina Easterly?
Yes.
Lisa French?
No.
Danny Garrett?
Yes.
Melanie Jacobs?
Yes.
Superintendent Lazard?
Yes.
Michael Ortega?
Yes.
Brad Prudhomme?
Yes.
Caroline Romer?
No.
Robert Schaff?
Yes.
Ariel Test?
No.
Sorry, I
didn't hear. You said no.
And Gina Womack? Now we're voting for Gina.
Actually, that motion passed.
It
renders,
Louisiana Revised Statute 17.252
Louisiana revised statute. We had a juvenile justice reform act 1225 in 2003 that mandated the implementation of a model master plan of discipline developed by DESA. I was very frustrated in my job here for 5 years as we transitioned in this building to a posture of believing that teachers and assistant principals and principals and all the people working in a schoolhouse, as long as they threw out pearls of wisdom in front of children, that everything would take care of itself. That a good teacher, good instruction, good testing, good assessment of any kind would make issues involving problematic behaviors just go away. And I don't believe that. I believe from the bottom of my heart that a proactive, preventative, and educative model of working with children is a pound of prevention being worth, right? A pound of cure, so to speak, to mess with that phrase a little bit. For too long in education, we have been reactive, punitive, and exclusionary. And those words that I use are basically echoing and paraphrasing legislation I've read at the state level and the national level in my career. This is my 37th year in education. I hope and I pray that we as a team can come together and figure out a constructive, viable way to do more than pay lip service to the purpose and intent of the best model master plan. And having said that, we have an agenda here. The first one was to elect the chair. Have. And it says the next piece in order of business was the approval of the minutes, February 1st, 2019. And so the committee that's present, do I have a motion to accept the minutes as they were written for the February 1st, 2019 meeting?
So
I have a motion. Have a second.
Right.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any those opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Next is the update on the discipline related legislation proposed in the 2019 legislative session. And that will be led by the Department of Education's representative.
I'm doing number 5.
Lisa, do you want me to speak to that?
Yeah.
Oh. Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay.
Hi, I'm Erin Bendley. I lead policy and governmental affairs for the department, which includes managing all things education across the street here in the legislative session. So as many of you recall, a lot of the work that you have put in the past couple of years on a piece of legislation was submitted, I think, by the chair at that time to a legislator that was very interested in the topic and agreed to introduce a bill, and that was Senator Wesley Bishop. So I know that he and the chair at the time worked a lot with Senate staff on the draft of that bill and ultimately filed a piece of legislation. And my understanding, and others that were part of these discussions may want to chime in, but my understanding is that after the bill was filed, there were a number of conversations with several different groups. Questions that I think arose about the bill, maybe even some concerns. And after he had a number of conversations with different stakeholder groups, the author of the bill decided not to advance the bill, meaning that it was never scheduled for a committee debate. It never really started going through the process to be considered by the legislature. So we did end the legislative session without that bill having advanced through the legislative process. So at this moment in time, the statutes on the books related to discipline and behavior and a
So at this point, I'd open it up to anyone else in the room who was part of those conversations, you know, with the author of the bill or with others. You may have more to add. Some of you, I think, were more involved in those conversations than we were. But if there's anything else that anyone else would like to offer up in terms of an update, we'd love to hear from you as well. But just wanted to give you that formal update on the status of the bill.
For those that are new to the group, we do have working groups, including a legislative working group. And I know Gina and Sean and Victor, I don't remember who else was in the room that day, was there Brad? We did meet as a legislative group when the bill was filed by Senator Bishop, and we ultimately as a group did not support the bill for multiple reasons. One being that it was not the bill that we all had worked to get over the last, year and a half. It was significantly different. I think it came with good intentions, and the intentions, it seems to be, was that the legislator and probably the Senate ed staff were trying to create a single place where all discipline law existed. If you're familiar with discipline law now, it's all over the books, and so I think they thought that a better first step was to try to get everything in one spot, and in an attempt to do that, it became really complex and difficult to follow. It was a 70-page bill. In that process, they also made some changes that, again, as a group, we had not been part of that decision making. So just as a FYI, the legislative working group said, you know, we can't support this. We did not go out and actively work against it. We just said as a body, it was not something that the council had voted on, and therefore we could not put our stamp of approval on it. And so that's kind of what I know.
I'd also add that there was not a meeting scheduled of the advisory council, so there really wasn't an opportunity to have any additional discussion. So
that's a good point. Yeah.
I think we were uncomfortable as a group in saying anything other than as individuals we couldn't support.
And there were definitely those involved that day in that particular meeting, and I looked down at Eugenia, who actually thought that the bill still did not resolve for their organizations what they see to be some really egregious pieces of law around discipline, and that it did not address this.
Right. Well, to add to that, I mean, the body worked on some legislative language, and there was a recommendation. So I think what was missing from what you just said was that when we submitted the final recommendations to the legislative committee, it included the changes that was made to the legislation and it made recommendations to do what ultimately ended up happening.
Yes, you're right. Yeah, so and it was really hard to track exactly where our changes were in the bill versus not.
Right. So in an attempt to do what our request was, there was, I felt like there was confusion with the groups, because I think there wasn't an understanding that once the request was made that we would not get back the more detailed changes to the legislative body. And so the committee, in attempt to give the group what we're asking for, they did the recommendations, which consolidated and brought in an attempt to make it clearer so that we could make more substantial changes maybe this session.
I'd like to make a motion to bring the work that we did on 17-416 back to the legislature in its entirety as 17-416, not in composing all the laws and okay, that's originally how we started. So I'd like to bring it back to the legislature and then back to the vice.
Brad brings up a good point, and Caroline mentioned it too when Caroline shared that there was a working subcommittee, the legislative committee. So I think it's important for you as the new chair and new members to know that there are currently six So I think there needs to be the discussion of these six committees and whether or not this council needs to maintain those six. And the membership, obviously, will change for these because the membership of the broader council has changed. And so one of those subcommittees was a subcommittee to write a draft report. And its members were Brad Prudhomme, Daphne Robinson, Julie Como, Sean Fleming, Kevin George, and Larry Davis. A second committee is the committee that was just referenced, and that is the committee or the working group to study and review the law. That's the legislative committee. And there were about 9 people on there. A lot of these people have transitioned. There was a representative from the LDOE who's no longer with us, so I am that representative now. Alan Coulter, Sean Fleming, Danny Garrett, Raymond Jetson, Victor Jones, Ariel McConduit, Brad Prudhomme, Caroline Romer, Rob Slicker, who's no longer with us, and Gina Woman. Then the third subcommittee is the Data Quality Review Committee. The LDOE representative, Alan Coulter, Sean Fleming, Brad Prudhomme, Michael Ortega, Robert Slicker, who's no longer with us, and Gina Woman. Then the other three subcommittees are, one is dealing with challenging behavior. The members were Tamara Cupid, Tia Edwards, Kevin George, who's no longer with us, Superintendent Lazara, you would be his replacement, Michael Ortega, Brad Prudhomme, and Gina Warman. The next one is Proactive Positive Approaches. Its members are Joanne Acord, who's no longer with us, an LDOE representative, who would be myself, Christina Conforto, who's no longer with us, Gina Easterly, Sean Fleming, Liz Gary, Melanie Jacobs, Ariel Conduit, no longer with us, Sydney Rutherford, and Deborah Weinberg, who's no longer on the council. Then the sixth and final committee is Safe Schools and Climate. Members are Alan Coulter, Danny Garrett, Jill Lockhart, no longer here, Lacey Polizzolo, Caroline Romer, Rob Slicker, no longer here, Judge Kim Stansberry, and Ariel Test.
Yeah, well, you know, this last year I never missed a day in our school as an assistant principal, and this year this is my first. I'm not absent from work, so. I think it's on a little unwieldy, I think, probably for a lot of people here who gainfully employed as full-time servants in the public, private, you know, trying to get away from your job repeatedly like that to serve on multiple committees or any committees other than this committee. I think that's a lot to ask some people, and I think you set yourself up maybe for failure. So I would like to now. We have a discussion about how many committees we're going to have and who's going to be on them, because it's, like I said, we didn't really discuss where everybody was from here in this room. I personally work in St. John, reside in Thibodaux, LaFouche Parish. I got here today, you know, by automobile, and so did everybody else. Let's go around. We from Brad and Williams still?
Still from Big Mac. I live in Youngsville. Which is left?
Which is left here? Sir?
I work with Jeff Davis.
Jeff Davis.
Bill Platt. Name of Parish.
Emmanuel Parish.
Hi, Dana Henry, Urban League Louisiana from New Orleans. I'm actually the appointee of Ariel Condon, moved to executive director of City of New Orleans.
Where you hail from, man?
I'm from Baton Rouge, but Tory is in our New Orleans office. Tory is in New
Orleans. I'm between Baton Rouge and New Orleans. New
Orleans. And that's your parish?
That's the parish.
Right. Tapia. Baton Rouge.
Slide out.
Baton Rouge.
Baton.
So we have a bitch, you know, it's not everybody who's coming from a great distance. So, let's have a discussion on that. I wasn't here. Y'all are going to have to get me up to speed. How did we end up with so many committees of this committee, you know, subcommittees? What was the rationale behind that?
Well,
called.
I don't know about this history. I think we have to figure out what it is we want to try and accomplish.
Okay.
And, you know, speaking as somebody who's been an observer and a member, I'm more concerned about exactly what the council, you know, is charged to do and what, in fact, we want to accomplish. And I can tell you that, for me personally, I'm very interested in what the data tell us, because we get a lot of anecdotal stories, but we really need good, accurate data. And obviously, there's an interest in trying to simplify the legislation. So those are two committees that exist, I think, historically. I can't speak to how the other committees actually got originated.
Dr. Coulter, I think that the big group was almost, they had so many people, they had so many different ideas. I think Sean is the one who started the subcommittees. I think he wanted to kind of break them down, try to narrow down the ideas. But I don't know if that really achieved anything, because there was, to me, there was nothing at the back end. What were the committee's goal? To what product were they supposed to come to? Or maybe I just didn't understand it. The legislative committee had, that was one that had an end product. That was their goal, to get what we did through the legislature this past year. But the rest of them, there wasn't really an organizational tool, you know, to do it or whatever. So I don't.
Like wasn't I said, an output.
There wasn't it. Correct. So.
I would just add, to answer your question, Rob, how did we end up with so many subcommittees? When this council was initially formed, our inaugural chair created three subcommittees. Then when there was a transition to a new chair, that new chair created three subcommittees. So that is how we ended up with six. But I would agree with Alan in that we need to discuss and agree as a council, and obviously reference back to the legislation that supports this council. What is our end goal or objective, and allow that to drive the priority of the committees?
So as a longstanding member, as are some of the others at the table, we worked really long and hard to get what we submitted to the legislature. Those that are new to the body perhaps have not gotten to fully read that work and understand if you embrace it or not. So I'm kind of in the spot of like, I'm ready to be done. I'll be blunt. I have come a lot, as have others. I think we did some good work. I'm in a spot where I'm ready to decide, are we good with that work? And are we going to push that work through the legislature? And I don't know if that ends things. I'm sure some would argue there's more to be done. But speaking strictly for our organization, we're ready to support the work that's been done here, see if we can get that passed legislatively, and go home.
Ms. Romer, I think a lot of us would agree with you on that. My question is, was it a product of having a senator that didn't do what was done, or is it just, this is what we're going to expect with the
bureaucracy? I think that's a good question. I believe that the legislation that was proposed last session came with the right intentions, good intentions, because I do believe it probably does need to be somehow compiled into one place and reviewed, but I think we should remember what we were tasked with doing. And did Senator Bishop's bill meet what was laid out for us as a group? So, you know, respectfully, Mr. Chair, I'm not sure which direction to go. Is it revisiting what the legislation requires of us to do and understand, do we feel we've done that with the piece of legislation that we were ready to propose? And if so, move that forward? Or if we think there's more work to be done, I don't know what direction to go, but I just feel like our work has never been presented as a piece of legislation, and I would like to see that happen. Now, maybe with new people at the table again, maybe you want to look at what we've done and there might be things to tweak or add to it. I'm not sitting here saying no touch, but just saying we should review that.
So, I have a question. Ms. Bendley, you know, your name wasn't attached to this. It says update on discipline-related legislation proposed in the 2019 session. So we have legislation as proposed?
It was proposed in the last session.
It says in this session. It says the 2019 session, would it be 2020?
Yeah, that last one. That's the last one.
It was proposed in the most recent legislative session, which was the spring of 19.
Okay.
There's not another session until spring
2020.
Of 2020.
Yes.
And at that point, basically, you know, every time you introduce a piece of legislation, that has to be done each time. So whoever the chair is, or you know, however the script wishes to do that, would work with the legislature to find Senator Bishop is not continuing in the legislature, so someone would need to find a new author to work with and once again submit what this group supports to staff to introduce it as a new bill.
And I appreciate what Ms. Roma's indicated. So I would say we have to have a discussion. That was her opinion, for one big person on the committee. So let's go around the table and have a discussion first as to whether where that piece of legislation that was proposed, where it was. I heard what Mr. Brad said that he's thinking about maybe tweaking it, retooling it into one piece of legislation. Go ahead, sir.
I'm probably one of the oldest members, longest term in this committee. I was in this committee in general. Because there's such a large body that changed, the chair developed a legislature, and we met many, many, many times in the wisdom
committee.
Right. We worked very, very hard. We met many times. Okay. And then we brought it back to the whole body, and actually I was one of the people that was talking in favor of it, and we received a unanimous decision by this committee. Okay. And when we submitted it, it was told that we were too late to the legislature. When we submitted it, it was such a big bill that they didn't have time to put it together. So we submitted again this last legislature. And it wasn't exactly what we exactly what I wanted. I wanted 17-416, which we worked real hard on for almost 2 years. The bill ended up putting all the educational bills together. It became a huge document in Carolina Senate, like 70 pages. So when I made the motion just a few minutes ago, was to bring it back as 17-416, which this whole advisory committee unanimously passed. And that's why I'm going back to that document, getting it ready to send it to the next legislative session in time so we don't have a hurdle saying we're too late. That's why I brought it up.
So what's to become of all the work, 70 pages? You know, if somebody came up with 70 pages of stuff,
it's what it's supposed to be.
Yeah,
if I could. And none of this is going to be, and I'm not going to take it the wrong way. I do the legislation sort of quarterly. Okay, but it's not just we send a bill to the legislature. The only way a bill gets before the legislature is if a legislator agrees to put their name on it.
Sure.
And as a practical matter, no matter what you give them, you can draft, I've drafted many bills down to the period. And I used to do that when I was on legislative staff. And I give it to the legislator, they give it to a staffer, the staffer is going to make changes. Sometimes they're substantive, sometimes they're not substantive, sometimes there's some, and then the bill is what actually the legislator follows. I think one of the things that happened in this past session is, at least from my notes, we were essentially walking through what everybody refers to as the state discipline law, 416. and we have discussion. I mean, we were going almost line by line and looking at things going, this doesn't make any sense, this doesn't make any sense, this should be better, this should be different, and we started making changes. What ultimately got filed by Senator Bishop was not reflective, I didn't think, of the last version of what we had worked on. So I think we do need to figure out what it is we want to accomplish. And if we want to take the state discipline law and because I think there was consensus on some things, that there are some provisions of it that are out of date, there are some provisions of it that appear to kind of conflict internally, and that we can make it a better law, and then you submit that to a legislator, ask them if they are willing to file a bill that is substantially the same as that, understanding that it might not be exactly what we give them. Because the legislator might make decisions going, well, you know, I understand what y'all voted on, but I'm not real comfortable changing that piece, or I'm not comfortable with that proposed change. So they're going to direct staff to draft it how they want. I think, to Brad's point, I think we could pick up with sort of the last revision of 416, because I appreciate we were doing it kind of the way lawyers do a contract, and that is with strike-throughs and add-ins, so you can tell what's being removed, what's being added. I think, you know, people were making suggestions for how they wanted to go, and then we were talking about those. And I think we could pick up there and move forward. As a sort of a practical legislative matter, there are some legislators who've already been reelected because nobody ran against them. There's a bunch of legislators who hadn't been reelected. They won't. Some of them will be elected in October. Some won't be reelected until after that. But we will need to, from a practical standpoint, for a significant change in the law, get a proposed draft to a legislator so they can get it to staff absolutely by the end of February, if you realistically want to see a significant bill get drafted, because staff's going to take some time to do it. So, I mean, that may be a way to move forward, is simply give to everyone, particularly those that are new, that last mock-up of 416 and see what people think of it. And so that's just that seems to be, I think, a way to at least move forward.
Can I just add to that? In addition to what has been said, I feel like we keep missing is the law change in 2018 that added additional members to this committee, but it also required that, or stated that we needed to look at all of the current laws and policies regarding student discipline, right? And so, yes, there was work that had happened 2 years before, but then you had the legislation from 2018. So what Sean did was gave to Senator Bishop the changes, the substantial changes that was made to 17416, and recommendations that we obviously went through and agreed upon that also needed to happen. If you all remember, and I can't remember exactly what those recommendations were, and that entire packet is what went to Senator Bishop and his committee. So in an attempt, this is just my understanding of it, in an attempt to give us what we were asking for, which were looking at the entire statute, because what sometimes happens when you are making changes to various statutes, you may contradict some other parts of the discipline, you know. And so what I understood the committee was saying is that there were pieces of legislation in several, you know, there was discipline things in several areas that were contradictory. And so in her attempt to give us something that we asked for, which was not the substantial, the line-by-line changes, was to consolidate and put things all together. So that 70-page document we had was all of the laws that exist based on Act 600. And so we had a clean slate to then, if that would have moved, which a lot of us didn't agree on, but it was the law that was already in place. So we weren't really changing anything, we were just consolidating. So I think where we go from here So I just wanted people to get a clear understanding that Senator Bishop didn't defy what we asked. As a matter of fact, like his committee people actually was giving us more of what we asked for. It just could not happen at the same time.
Just a very practical thing for the group to consider. And I think these questions kind of came up when the committee's recommendations made their way across the street. As Danny described, just the process of taking what someone gives you and turning that into an official piece of legislation involves a lot of things. I mean, there are legislative staff who get trained and paid to write a bill a certain way, and there are certain ways that they word legislation, and that may not be consistent with what a group gives them. So they may say, well, you've worded it this way, but you just don't word things like that in statute. There's a certain technical way that we have to write legislation. And so I think sometimes there were perceptions that legislative staff just weren't doing what this group asked them to do, when actually, could have been just a translation issue, could have just been that's not really a proper way to word something in statute. But unfortunately, there was no way every time they recommended a change to reconvene a meeting, come here and explain it to everybody, and go back. And it's a very quick process. If you're talking about what ended up being a 70-page bill, it's just not practical to have that back and forth with the legislative staff. So I would just suggest that if this group does want to give it another try, I think it's really important to authorize either chair plus a couple of people, have a small group that can kind of be on call and authorize them to work with staff to kind of go through it, figure out how to resolve issues without compromising what it is you're trying to achieve. It may be that legislative staff says we really need to word it this way, or you need to organize it differently. As long as it doesn't really change what this group is intending to accomplish, that may be resolvable, but it might be good to have a couple of people authorized to kind of go broker those, hate to call them deals, but are just kind of to work out those issues, because it's just not practical to say, oh, well, I've got to wait until we bring this back before the whole group, reconvene the meeting. It's just not practical, the speed at which you have to work on getting this stuff ready before certain deadlines. It's a very fast process, and for a bill that is this big, it could require a couple of months of work to get it right.
But fortunately, we have on this committee a lot of people with a lot of experience involving concerns about behavior and how to address behavior appropriately with children. We have some people that are administrators, have been administrators in the audience, who sometimes have seen and experienced people just being, as I've said earlier, reactive and punitive and exclusionary, and their solution to the problems to vanish, right? Just get rid of problems. There's other people in this room that are cut from a different cloth. They are more designed to looking at what can we do to solve those problems. So I support Ms. Mendeley's idea 100%. I think we should take time and put a committee together that consists of people on, I don't want to say political ends of the spectrum, philosophical. We should have a heterogeneous group of people to make sure that all attitudes, positions, or inside that committee. And for people to introduce themselves, I'm certain that you are Mr. Sean, because Mr. Fleming and I worked together when I was at the department, and so I know exactly what he brings to the table and his attitude about children. So I would like to, my first,
sure. So I just need clarification, listening, Gina, to your comments. Where are you looking at? Like, I feel like your comments on what we do is expanded from what I thought we did. Like, I'm looking at 217-253, is that right? Whatever created this body. are you looking at other things? Like when I look at that first paragraph of what it is we do, and then the last paragraph about the written report, you have more. I feel like you have more in what you say you do than what this says.
I'm looking at the last of the reveal that was next.
Yeah, what can you give me numbers so I know what we're looking at?
At 600 of 2018.
What's the bill number again?
600.
Do you know where it is in the law? Yes.
It's under session 2018.
So 17-2, you're still in 17-253? You were giving a description of what we do as a group, and I'm asking, what, where are you looking to get your information?
At 600.
I think I can bring some clarity to it. Act 600 amended Louisiana Revised Statute 17-253. And added five new members to this body. Then, and I think this is what Gina's talking about, in section two of that bill, it did not insert it into the statute, but in section two of that bill, that's where it talks about the advisory council on student behavior and discipline shall review current state laws, policies, and regulations regarding student behavior and discipline, and shall submit a written report of its findings, including recommendations for needed changes to the Senate Committee on Education, House Committee on Education, and the State Senator who represents Senate District 4, not later than February 15, 2019.
Right.
So that's why if you look into 253, you won't find any of that, because
that's not in the bill.
It's not in the statute.
That's not law.
Well, it is part of the act. It's an expression of the legislature's intent and really, it got so narrow as to tell us which legislator we had to submit our information to, which I actually have never seen that before until that was done. And I knew, but that was the senator, and he wanted to come through his office. Now, I think one of the issues is, particularly when you look at it coming in last session, that timeline, and like I brought up, that timeline makes it very difficult for a bill of this size. I think to Aaron's point, because you give it to their staff come up, first of all, they have multiple pieces of legislation they're drafting, not just one. And they come up with a first draft, and normally, I've seen legislation in my time on staff have 8, 10, 12 iterations before it actually gets filed. But you have to have it done by a certain date to get it through five. Certainly that section is really no longer applicable because it has a deadline on it that's impossible to meet because we're well past it. So that section two would really not govern what we're doing now because it can only have governed what the commission did leading up to February 14, 2019.
And that's fine, I was just saying what happened with this legislative session, which I thought was a crucial part of the conversation, because the conversation was as if that didn't happen, and that's why the recommendations that Sean sent that we as a committee agreed upon is what ended up with the final product.
The final product being Bishop's bill or our product? Bishop's bill was not this council's product. So when you say the final product.
I'm confused as to why you keep saying that, because we authorized when Sean.
Okay. So, Ms. Womack, I want to just for a point of clarification. I want to make sure I understood what I just heard. Okay, so this group came up with something that looked like a certain way, and I've heard several people in the room say, it looked like this piece of paper here, but then it got to Senator Bishop and his staff, and the legislative staffers who have expertise in drafting legislation and legalese or whatever terminology or verbiage it has to be. It was different. It was not, was any of the differences substantially different in meaning of what y'all proposed to?
Yes. It was different because, and Sean, maybe you can interject, Sean sent the changes to the law and recommendations that this committee
lesser, the original spirit, intent, and wording of what this committee approved, was there any significant, substantial changes to what Senator Bishop's bill would have looked like as law had it passed and not died?
Sure, before I do that, I want to just make it clear for the record that it is questionable whether anything that's occurred during this meeting is whether it's subject to violation of open meetings law. I received notice of this agenda at 11:11 yesterday morning. It was posted on the department's website at 10:32 yesterday morning.
I had a sign out on here.
And you have a sign. It's required 24-hour notice.
I had a sign on this.
As an FYI.
I can't control what Bessie does. I sent it to them, but
it's not notice of a meeting under the open meetings law is posting the notice on the door.
Right.
Physically posting it on the door, not emailing it or putting it on your website. So if you put it on your website after you put it on the door, as long as you put it on the door within 24 hours of the meeting, you've met the requirements of 4219 and it's desired.
I've had parents tell me they had issues with one who was on the agenda yesterday. So I put that on the table. It's hard to delay anything in this hour.
Mr. Funk, with all due respect to you, sir, which you know I have, I will say to you in a gentle rebuttal, let's just say this, everybody came almost from Timbuktu to Webster Parish. Even if it turns out what we say and what we do may not be official, we can always rectify that in a public meeting. Even if you are correct and he is incorrect, we can always make decisions which are not official, and then we come back to the next meeting. If we have public notice, we can rectify that.
I'm bringing up a concern that was raised to me by parents who called me yesterday about their participation in this process.
That they weren't able to be here.
Correct.
Okay, that's a valid concern.
And they did not know what was on the agenda.
They have a chair.
So, my understanding of what happened in the last session with the entire, the vote from this body was the same vote that we made in February of 2018 related to some changes in RS-17-416. That's what we submitted as the recommendations from this body. And those changes, those recommendations never changed. We went through a year, and those were submitted on September 10th to Wesley Bishop of last year, of 18, after our legislative committee reviewed them, and I think directed me at one of our meetings to do that. It's all been a bunch of minutes of all this. There was no draft provided until relatively late in the game, I'll say. And we were given two options to think about. And I think it wasn't the full scope of all the details, but I can't remember what the other one contained in it. But one was whether we, some of the recommendations we had were some principles to change. And one of those principles was to consider like reorganizing, restructuring some of the stuff and cleaning up some language and considering whether certain labels or definitions should be in statute or reserved for the rulemaking process. What resulted from that was a very monstrous bill. I can't remember, how many pages, 70 pages. I mean, I broke it down as best I can. The legislative work group tried to discern whether it matched current statute. In the end, during our meetings, determined there were some inconsistencies with it. There were some changes. I think the changes were inadvertent from legislative staff's attempts to restructure the law, but they perceived it would cause confusion and conflict, not only in the short-term contract to do it, but because it created some contradictions in what to do in certain disciplinary situations. I mean, I didn't bring all my notes with me. I do have them on my computer, but that's kind of irrelevant in terms of all the details. But we decided, even as a legislative work group, my recollection was that it was too much for us to even make the recommendations for this panel to endorse, but then the chair at the time of this, the Advisory Council of Behavior Discipline, chose to not schedule any meetings during the legislative session, so there was not even an opportunity for this body to officially weigh in. Nor do I think, this is now I'll get into my opinion of what our third authority is. I think we can give thoughts on legislation, but I don't think this body can necessarily like endorse legislation, but maybe endorse ideas within legislation. Wesley Bishop's bill had, in my opinion, it was a good attempt at trying to restructure some things and clean up some things, but it was so massive in its scope, some details were, we did not have time to even, and neither did the person who was crafting it. I think it was all good intent, but to catch all the inadvertent inconsistencies in it. There weren't a lot, but there
was. By the way, I'm curious, with respect to the Bessemer Master Plan for Discipline, did it address the letter G, which is on revised statute 253? Because according to, I wasn't given a copy of this other follow-up legislation. All I had in my folder, and was emailed to me, was 253 or 252, one which I was familiar one with from my previous life here in the department, and the other one I was not, and I don't have it. But it says the advisory council, this group, shall annually submit a written report to the Senate Committee on Education, the House Committee on Education, the State Board of Education, regarding its findings and recommendations with respect to the implementation of the school master plans for improving discipline. Did it address that, sir? Did y'all address that? Because that's what it seems the main original focus was in this legislation.
Senator Bishop's bill did, last year, did incorporate 17252 within it. The described intent was to actually not change things, but there were some parts of law that were perceived as outdated or had dates related to them that are referred to commissions and such that did not do it. There was one change in related to 17252 that I can recall specifically that would have changed the language a little bit, and that was raised as a concern of how it did that. Because the original 253 referred to a commission. Interagency commission that does not exist anymore. So I don't know if that answered your question. They didn't go into like G and try and change the specifics in here, though.
No, I'm talking about the fact that it says that this group was supposed to have findings and then provide recommendations about the implementation of 252.
Those were maintained in there. Yeah. I mean,
did we make any recommendations to anybody? Did this body make any recommendation to anyone? It says regarding its findings or in respect to the extent that Louisiana schools implemented master plans for improving behavior and discipline. I may be reading it wrong. Am I reading wrong, Dr. Cole? Somebody help me. It says here that this group is supposed to look at the master discipline says, that's what I'm reading.
Yeah.
I think I'm reading it right.
I actually spoke, if I may, incorrectly when I spoke earlier about presenting legislation, because that's what I was getting to when I started reading. I'm like, oh wait, I'm wrong, because this says recommendations, findings, etc., and that certainly isn't necessarily in the form of legislation, probably. So I stand corrected, and that's why, Gina, I was saying, wait,
To make it more very concrete, so if I turn Ms. Bentley right now, say Ms. Bentley, you know, we have 252, and it requires that every single school district in Louisiana include charters, which Ms. Roller represents. Did every one of those schools, through the superintendent, submit to the department, as I asked them to do when I worked here, they submit an assurance document that they were implementing the provisions of Louisiana Revised Statute 252. That's what that says to me. Findings, that we ask her a question, or Ms. French, do you have a file in Mr. Como's office, where I used to work? I saw Mr. Como still there for coffee this morning. Can Mr. Como tell me, if I go to see him, that all of these districts have verified that they're implementing the provisions of 252? So to me, that is a finding.
That's something that I can ask Mike about. My understanding, and I'm happy to go back and talk to him, is that the law does not specifically require us to do some sort of annual survey of school districts. That's not to say we couldn't do it. There are times that different groups have asked us to survey school districts on a number of things, and we do it all the time. We have a newsletter that goes out once a week to school districts. If that would be the will of this group, would be to formally ask the department to survey school districts, that would be something that we are happy to do, collect information, and then bring back to you. I don't know if that's something that this group has formally recommended, and therefore I don't know that our staff actually went out and requested that districts provide us that information. Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
As I listen to the discussion, I think we have two streams of thought going on.
Okay.
One is that this council has made considerable progress in suggesting revisions to 416. And those revisions, obviously, as you heard Mr. Garrett say, the council can only give information to a senator or a representative, and then it has to go to staff to work on that legislation. That's a narrow point, and I think part of what you hear from the historic members of the council is they'd like to make progress on that one point. As I appreciate it from Ms. Womack in particular, there's an expanded purpose for looking at legislation from the council. That to me is a different issue, and would in fact require some additional committee work. But if I heard Mr. Krugenholm correctly, he really wants to move, and I think Ms. Romer agrees, he really wants to move that one piece of consensus forward. And so I think we've really got a mixture of discussion here. I would appreciate it if we could focus on one and then move to the other.
I'll tell you what my point of paragraph B today, sir, for now. I won't forget it, but I'm going to table it. So, Mr. Caputo, so we feel like we all came across the stage and made some progress today. Let's move forward now, sir. You're going to entertain providing a motion, sir, about this one thing that you have in your mind, which is to fix the Louisiana Revised Statute 17:416.
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
Well, sir, go ahead and make your motion.
Okay. We've lost.
Before we get to second, sir, and Robert rules of order, you may well do so.
Okay. To me, we're all colleagues. We all want what's best for our students in the state of Louisiana. We have lost some members of this committee because they were heartbroken that we have not accomplished anything. that they have voted time and time and have not really accomplished. So I want to bring it back to the table because I will not give up. I will fight to the end to get something accomplished. And I would love to bring back 17416, which we have worked for 2 years. Because we have a new jobs, I want to bring it to our legislative committee one more time and then bring it to our full committee.
You have a legislator, so you're going to have a chance for your revisions for 17416.
Right, the reason why.
You have one, sir?
The reason why, Mr. Chair, is because we went from 17416 to compiling all the educational laws together. And that's why we came up with a 70-page document.
Mr. Prudhoe, what's the motion? I'm getting confused.
So I'm coming to the motion. I'm explaining myself.
Thank you.
There's a lot of new members here, and I want to clarify. Therefore, the motion is to bring back 17416 as it was written in the council passed by this committee.
With a copy, sir.
Mr. Shulman, who was chair, and he has a copy.
It's on the website. It's on the website. It's on Bessie's website. It's on the website. It was submitted in our annual report. I submitted the only recommendation that came out of this group last year. So it's all on record. All the files.
I said the motion. Thank you.
So we can have a roll call vote now?
Comment.
Discussion. Yeah. Mr. Pasqua, everybody knows Mr. Frank Pasqua, Esquire.
Frank Pasqua from Lafourche Path. I'm also the legislative chair for the Child Welfare and Attendance Association. But you know what? We are discussing what happened in the legislature. This committee, and I've been coming to all of these, never said to revamp all of the discipline laws. That's not what this committee recommended. We worked, and this committee worked hard, and you had significant progress, and we got a good thing going. And this is what we want. 17416, as it currently stands, is the basic law that principals use to implement discipline. As a child welfare director and supervisor in my parish, and I'm all over the state, the child welfare people, this is what we do. We implement the law. And people that implement the law day in and day out, we know where the weaknesses are. I know where the weaknesses are. And I was able to give some input, and we worked out and we progressed significantly. And the changes that we want to make will help our principals. 17416, which is the base law. Yeah, there's other laws. 17416.2, .3, .4, .5. And that was an attempt to put it all together and recodify it or renumber it. And .1, it's like that right now, but we are familiar with it as it is right now. But how they got that idea to do the whole thing and make it 70 pages, I don't know. But I have developed over the years our people a reference chart, a quick reference chart for a club, which quotes the law and track it off. And when I took this 70-page document and I started referencing it, I found at least 20 errors when they moved the data and renumbered it and moved the paragraphs over. They left some sentences out and they put some sentences where it wasn't supposed to be. I'm going to give you one example. I found 20 of them. One example says that if you bring a knife to school, all right, and it's so many inches long, 2 inches long at least, the blade, you shall be recommended for expulsion. Students shall be recommended for expulsion. But there's an exception. Students in pre-K to 5, who is less than 11 years old, may be recommended for expulsion. Well, what that 70-page document did, it not only put it for weapons, knives, it put it for drugs, all right, it put it for guns. And the law doesn't say pre-K to 5, less than 11 years old, if you bring a gun to school, you may be expelled. It was full of errors. And if I had time, it would take me about 45 minutes to show you all of them that I found from page 30 to 45. So whoever drafted this thing, didn't even proofread, didn't even cross-reference it. So we could not support a bill like that. But I like what I'm hearing today. I like what Ms. Rome said, I like what Ms. Goldstein said, and I think we ought to take what we pounded out for the last 2 years, which we all agree on in 17416, which is the basic law on suspensions and expulsion, and move forward with it to make some progress with it. And if we don't do this, I have two legislators back home, I'm gonna write my own bill. I didn't write the bill because I'm letting y'all do it. But I've been working on this way before this committee was formed. And I was ready to go. But I got legislators back home I could get, and I could make a bill for revision of 17416 myself. But I'd like to do it for y'all. Because it's better to have everybody agree on it, and we made significant progress. Don't throw that away. Move forward, please.
I'd like to move the question. Ms. Pope.
So does anybody have an objection to Mr. Bruder in this one second that we move forward and make our raison d'etre, our reason for being, at least at the moment, to revise Louisiana Revised Statute 17:416 to remedy innumerable inconsistencies and contradictions on that statute.
I don't think that's the motion. Can we hear the motion?
Yeah, what's the motion?
Try to do this. What I heard was Brad said he was moving to bring back the work that the legislative committee did, the original work that the legislative committee did on 17-416 as it was written, back to the full committee to go back to the legislature next year.
Thank you.
And that remedied all the problems that Mr. Pasquale alluded to?
Yes.
Fixed all those 20?
No, that was a different problem. That was a different year.
Right, but is it fixed?
Yes.
Okay.
Quick question. So we submitted it to the legislature, it got fouled up. We gotta go through this route again. Let's say we go through this route again. We submit it back to the legislature. Is there any ideas on, or best ideas on how not to happen again? Are we taking the same chance? Okay.
I'd be happy to take a gander at it. First of all, I think it would be appropriate for the body to come up with a legislator that we would request to carry the bill. And make the request to the legislature as narrow as you want it to be. If you're only asking that the legislator file a bill to propose our recommended amendments to 17416, then that's what the request needs to be. So to answer to Mr. Ortega's issue, that I think that's how you would address that. And with regard to did we solve everything? No, but I mean that's the nature of the committee. I think we solved the things that we could all agree to solve. There's an old saying in the legislative game: do not let the absence of perfection be the enemy of the good. Because you can make positive change and positive improvement to what everybody kind of universally believes is probably not a really great law. You can make benefits to it by making some changes. You're not going to make every change everybody wants to make, but at least if we make it better, we've served a function, I think. So I would be supportive of Mr. Prudhomme's motion, simply because I think if we start where we left off, and then if the full body would want to make any more changes that we could get consensus on, and then we give that discrete product to a legislator with that narrow request, I think we could have some success.
Yes, sir. Dana Henry, and I apologize again for coming in late. Just listening as a kind of fresh set of eyes and ears. The only question I have in good conscience before we vote is, do we agree on the scope of our role? Because I'm hearing a little bit of inconsistency about what we're charged to do. Is it a limited scope based upon the statute, or a broad scope based upon the statute? Because if we don't have consensus on what our role is, and we do get the recommendations back to the council, and we start going at it again in preparation for the next legislative session, I just want to make sure that as a body, we all agree on what the functional role and purpose of this body is before we start taking votes. So I think I heard two different perspectives on what we're supposed to be charged with doing.
So I think we can still, I think we still can vote on his motion.
No, you can. I'm in good conscience. I wouldn't be able to until I understand what that role is.
Go ahead, Dr. Colton.
Once again, we're trying to do two things at once, and I appreciate Mr. Prudhomme's motion because that's just trying to do one thing, which is to simply move forward on one piece. I'm very interested in having an additional discussion about other aspects of the legislation. So, you know, I think Mr. Fleming has the amended purpose of the council up on his laptop screen. You can read that to folks, especially to new members, so that you are informed about what our purpose is. But I don't want that to in any way take away from the fact that we're simply trying to get one particular purpose moved forward, then we can move on to discuss other things.
Dana, hi. I agree. I think that the original work that this body did is really good work that does line up with what we were tasked to do. And as said, it's just been very frustrating that we haven't even been able to move that one piece of work. And I'll remind you, this is a group of people that are very diverse in their thoughts around what needs to be happening. Again, all agree we want good stuff for kids, but have some very different thinking in how to do that. So I personally am really proud that we came up with something that was unanimously supported by the organization. And so I believe we can move that forward, and to answer your question, I do think it is responsive to what we were tasked to do, but I also think we have work moving forward onto your question. What fully is the scope and how do we want to move forward? I don't think by supporting this, it means that we won't do future things, but I think by supporting this, we're making a statement that this is a piece of work we did for over 2 years, and we've yet to see it come to fruition. And I think it would be very strong and powerful to see this type of group come together at the legislature in agreement on something of this nature.
Yes, sir.
When this group first was charged, it did not have that G component, 250. That was added in that 600 of 2018. Whatever that was. So
May 30th, 2018, it says here.
Prior to that, I had that question. You know, because we were charged prior to that insertion to make our recommendations to the Department of Education and BESSEL, which actually is part of the reason why we got behind the first year, because we didn't send our recommendations to the legislature, we were just sending it to BESSEL, and at the timing of the meetings where we produced that first set of suggestions for changing statute, we could only give it to them, and I think Aaron or whoever, you know, y'all reached out to a legislator and did some work before to try and make it happen in 17 or 18 when y'all did that.
It did pass the legislature, and it did, and it was vetoed by Jim Bill.
Right on. Well,
yes.
I don't recall it that way, but once 600 of 2018 put in a provision that we are to report to the legislature, and actually specific legislature at that, I felt like it gave us more flexibility to communicate directly to them if this body felt like changes in statute were interference with implementation of school model master discipline plans. That answers your question.
Let me ask a different way, because I don't want, I know there's a lot to do. The motion on the floor is that recommendations that were made by the council that were sent to the legislature, for whatever reason it didn't go through the process, that those recommendations come back to this council, I guess, for more work, right? That's
no,
not...
It's
submitted to the legislature,
so
who will champion.
So if it's submitted, is it safe to assume that every member of this council would say that the submission of those recommendations to that legislature, to the legislator, falls within the scope and authority of this board? Would anybody say, wait, that's not what we're supposed to be doing? Or do we have unanimous consent that everybody who worked on that says those recommendations that we're going to submit falls clearly within the scope of either the enabling legislation of this advisory committee council or Act 600 of 2018? Would anybody say, no, this falls outside the scope of what we're charged to do by either one of those laws? If not, then I can vote. I'm just trying to get it caught up because I'm hearing a whole bunch of different. I'm hearing Act 600. I'm hearing.
I'm actually a different question. It's no disrespect to you, but I don't have a membership list of who can vote. Like, are you the who?
I'm a designated Urban League Louisiana.
Urban League.
That's
okay.
Not. He's not Brent.
Oh, you're not Brent.
No,
Brandon.
I'm not Brent.
I'm sorry. I'm not like Blair. I can't even see you.
No, I'm sorry. I'm actually supposed to be down there.
I got you.
Someone in clarified, sir. Before you came in.
I'm going to contest me in the Urban League. I don't know what kind of a result.
Right.
No.
So he is a voting member. He's not a proxy, sir.
Okay. All right. So, yeah, I think we have that authority and responsibility, actually. You know, and this body felt like it had that responsibility to suggest changes to the statute even prior to submitting them directly to the legislature. It was just the process of doing it.
I'm going to follow Mr. Coulter's question. We have a motion on the
second by
Ms. Womack. Do we have anybody in opposition?
I want to ask Danny if he did a friendly amendment to that to recommend submitting it to a direct legislator or asking the department to secure a legislator.
I thought it was his motion.
I know, but is that included in the motion?
As I appreciate his motion, again, young reader, I thought it was just to bring it back to this body. Now, once this body then votes on it and says yes, you know, or tweaks it or whatever.
I feel that we have to give new members
the opportunity to take a look at it.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I think
but in the interest of time, because I heard y'all say things have a tendency to start crawling, we do have electronic media. We can email all the members. Members can review it and become up to date on it.
So then I'll ask the second question before I vote, because I'm fine with voting yes, to be clear. My only concern is it took 9 months for this group to convene.
That's a chair.
Okay.
Mr. Fleming, I don't know who the other person was and what his schedule was like, but with you on my back, sir, I can assure you, it will not be 9 months. You know me, and you will not allow that to happen.
So, it's just to make sure everybody's clear that
I'm clear.
If we want the legislator to pick it up and run with it, we need to give it to them.
It will be a contest between you and Brad, who pushes me the hardest.
I just
want
to make it
first.
Clear, last year I gave the same recommendations to the legislator before this date. And we're talking about it again.
You will set a deadline for me to make sure I do what I need to do, right? Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you very much.
I'll expect you to set a deadline, and I respect you.
But you make sure I do.
I just make sure we're aware of that. And we will have to reconvene with a quorum to do this. I'm fine. I'll call the question if y'all need to. I'd like to vote there.
All right, me too.
I call the question. Yeah, let's go.
All right, Dr. Coulter had a question that was ignored for 10 minutes ago.
Let's go.
I was alerted that we can just, anybody in opposition? Okay, we finish it. Pass unanimously. Okay. Now, this gentleman, Mr. Henry.
Yes, sir.
I do want to ask one question, Mr. Fleming. Can you help me with this, sir? This number 600 of May 30th, 2018. My question for you, are you saying that it in some way rescinds my obsession about whether G and what G means? Because G tells me that a conversation you and I had about the Bessie Model Master Plan, I would say that one of the things that we exist for is very simply to make sure that the Bessie Model Master Plan for discipline and behavior is being implemented with fidelity throughout the land of Louisiana. And the only way I can see it doing it is in contradiction with Ms. Bentley said behind me. You know, we don't ask someone if they're doing something, and how do you know that they are? There is accountability that we might need.
So, to answer your question, G is just who we report to. If you look at A, 253A, and I was confused before because I thought you were 252. 253A has always been the defining purpose of this body, and it's to, for us, this group, to provide advice and guidance to BESSE and the corporate head regarding best practices in providing support to public school governing authorities in the adoption of the DCU school master plan for school behavior and discipline, and then it lists 252, which goes to all that. To your point, there seems to have been clarity last year. I lose track of the years, but where the Department of Ed seemed to express it didn't even think the Model Master Discipline Plans was required anymore, where all the school systems did, because I appreciated it. That's what I understood. Now, I'll take you back to some recommendations that this body did make, and some promises that were made that I do not believe were fully kept. And that's related to your point of data integrity. Because if I look at, if we're going to actually know what's going on, we need to have accurate data. And the one thing that this group also did back in late 2016, early 2017, was realize that the data on discipline in this state had no integrity to it. There was questions. There was, and I'll share a couple of questions. One is the implementation. So implementation means we know how well practices are being employed, and the Department of Ed shared with us data that indicated, I think it was over 900 schools were implementing PBIS to fidelity at school-wide levels, and hundreds are doing it at individual, you know, student levels. And there's no validity checks on any of this. All of the data, the implementation data and the outcome data, how many kids are suspended, removed, etc., it's all self-report, and there is no mechanism of validating any of it. And so because of these concerns, these were the, let me share the, from 2018, the 2017 report, these were the recommendations related to data integrity. The Department of Education made a couple of recommendations, and it was, they made three recommendations, and this was from February 10th of 2017. They proposed to review best practices for collecting, verifying, and reporting student discipline data, and proposed requesting feedback from this council on ways to improve these practices. They agreed to review SIS and all discipline data elements, goals, forms, definitions, and SIS, and agreed to have this council and other stakeholders suggest review suggested changes to discipline data collection systems. It would create a data quality review committee to assist with this review, and it would collect and annually report data on the implementation of positive behavioral interventions and supports. There were four additional recommendations that this body made. Two goes to three, and those include regarding their first recommendation is that they, in addition, assist is to include special education reports. So the second recommendation is to have the LEA staff consider external stakeholders to help in the process of reviewing the data. And as part of reviewing existing data systems, it should consider how data is utilized, and once it's
voted on? I'm sorry.
We voted on that, and that passed.
I think I missed that.
This passed, okay? And the significance of this is I do give the department credit. It has reported data, and it has done, I think, a good job in providing more reports on data on discipline, and we've seen that. The problem is the integrity of the data. This data quality review committee has met about once a year. The members of that committee here currently have been Alan, Dr. Coulter, Dr. Tate, Michael Tate, Gina Womack, and myself, and Brad. I'm sorry, Brad was on as well. And I would say, I have records of this, but about once a year we would meet. Sometimes we do a phone call, but that's not necessarily a meeting. The department has, this, if we don't have data, this is me, if we don't have data, we don't know where we are. And this request, this recommendation to the department, in my opinion, has fallen on a lack of action. And it's to your, I'm sorry, I'm not finished. It's to your point, is last year, I believe it was, when we realized they don't even believe they're responsible for any part of school model master discipline plans and the implementation thereof. And so, to your point, Mr. Henry, what's our purpose? If, to me, the first thing is the department doesn't even recognize its role in supporting schools in implementing model master discipline plans. And so,
Mr. Fleming, I'm ready to answer your concern, sir. This is a current statute. Up here, it says at the top that Mr. Henry wants to know what we're supposed to do for a living. Even today, serving pro bono.
Yes, sir.
It says that we're supposed to provide Ms. Bentley and Mr. White guidance about what the best practices are for ensuring that the master discipline plan and its implementation is being supported at the school level, the classroom level.
Yes, sir.
It says that that's what we're supposed to do, is tell Ms. Bentley and Ms. French and Mr. White and everybody else at the
Department of Education,
and that what is the best practices as we know it, using our pool of human resources in the room, our education, our background, our experience as educators and psychologists and the like. At the bottom, in G, it says once we do that, it says we're supposed to report our findings as to what, whatever way you say, sir, we will get data. When I was at the department, I lived in a suitcase, out of a suitcase you're aware of. We had 8 PBIS consortiums in 8 regions of the state. I traveled all over the state, training, running consortiums, and physically being where the rubber met the road, seeing if the BESSI model master plan was being implemented. I was a trainer of trainers. I was conducting consortium meetings. So I could report to this group then that that's what was taking place and how. Now, we'll be making recommendations to the committee as to some of that kind of work we might want to consider revisiting so that we can find out by taking actual, action research maybe in the field, and also there are some things that we can do. And I do agree with you, the first comment you made, that the data is just self-reporting data that we have right now, or in your case, you're reporting. There's no even self-reporting data, where we're not even putting somebody and holding responsible to say whether they're doing or they're not doing. The most important support, I'm going to make it crystal clear, that we can provide, is we have massive turnover in the teaching ranks, administrative ranks, in our school systems in Louisiana, including the one I work in. We have major turnover. And as the accountability of Louisiana has gotten greater and greater, and more has been asked of teachers, we've had even more teachers leaving the ranks of the class in the classroom. So I think we need to understand that some of them can't implement the BESSI model master plan because they have no idea what it is. The principals, and assistant principals, and teachers, counselors who are charged with the BESSI model master plan, I promise you, this would be one good set of data we could do. We could, survey them, send a survey out, and find out what they know about it. We could send them a test, have them go online and complete it, and see what they know about the BESSI model master plan. Survey Monkey data would be real easy to do, find out what they know and don't know about the Bessie Model Master Plan.
I am an original member, and I served from 2016 to 2018 as a parent of a child with disabilities who have been returning to schools. So, from a parent perspective, I am not in the classrooms of schools for employee practices, but I am at the receiving end of those practices, dealing with a child who is still recovering emotionally from what has happened to him in school. Emergency room visits with flashbacks and everything. So, I am on the receiving end of those practices, including punitive discipline, restraint, and seclusion. And we even touched on bullying initially when I was on the council committee and tackled the issue about it intensively. My position as a stakeholder is has been the value of accurate data. That is my tool to assess the implementation of best practices without the integrity of reporting. As a parent, I have to question the integrity of the practices.
How many other parents, since we'll stay three of them here, that have children that are special ed but not gifted, that have actual disabilities? You're one, there is two others in the room? Mr. Your council is supposed to provide three members, sir. Do you have two others?
These are the calls I referred to earlier. People did not know what was on the agenda. I'm just saying they got noticed the meeting was occurring, but they wondered what was going to be considered.
But we do have two more members? You're the one that provides, your organization. I just wanted to make sure something. Thank you. Okay, so Mr. Henry, how did we do on that one, sir? Does it sound to me like I answered your question?
Yep,
this is a robust organization here with a lot of power and authority according to what the statute. You are acknowledging, sir, Mr. Fleming, I trust you a lot. You're acknowledging that I'm correct in what the authority of this and responsibility of this body is?
Oh, I'm pretty clear on the responsibility.
So we need to be making recommendations about best practices to ensure that the Bessie Model Master Plan of Discipline exists and is being implemented in districts, not just in self-reporting and maybe some other robust ways we can talk about as we move forward.
I guess I would like to make a motion. I would like the department to report on the implementation of school model master discipline plans, on the status of that statewide.
We have a motion. We have a second.
My motion is I would like
speak up, Mr. Fleming.
I would like for the department to provide a status update on the implementation of school model master discipline plans across the state.
So based on the motion that I think Sean is putting on the floor, the department would like to respond. And so Aaron Findley, our assistant superintendent of policy, will respond to that.
So I know it's difficult to hear in this room with the echo. You just reviewed the responsibilities of this group was to give us information and recommendations about best practices.
Yes, reading from the law.
Yes, but now what I hear is a request to not give us information, but to ask us to go out and collect information to bring back to this group. Is that correct? For your consideration, to help you in your development of recommendations. Is that right? And one thing I just want to point out.
I'm sorry, Ms. Bentley, I want to clarify so it's clear that he's within his right to do so. It says advice and guidance. So that would be guidance. I don't know, I'm not a lawyer. We have one here, Mr. Garrett, you seem to be an attorney, sir. Is that correct?
Yes.
It doesn't specifically say request, but we're happy to accommodate as many requests.
Do we have a right to guidance means that we can, does that mean direct also, sir? Or would,
no, I don't believe you can direct the department.
Just like suggest.
You can request the department to provide that information. You can always request, but I don't think we can direct the department to go.
So that's not what the word guidance means?
I don't, no, I wouldn't think so. I don't believe that a task force can direct the operations of any department.
Okay, thank you.
And just as, you know, and again, we're happy to receive your request, and to the extent that we have the capacity to do what it is you're requesting, we're happy to make that attempt. But I just want to make clear, I want to be clear as to what you were asking us to do with this mission. You would be asking us to go out and basically survey all of the public school systems in the state, basically asking them a question: are you implementing a model master discipline plan? And if so, I'm assuming you would like a copy of that. Is that right? So we would ask them, we can't make them, but we would ask them, are you doing it? And then I'm assuming you would like to know something about how they are doing it, or can we get a copy of it? And you would want us to collect that from all 70, however many school systems we have, plus the charters. And this group is going to then wade through every single one of those documents. I just want to be clear about the workload that you're going to ask us to gather, and I want to make sure that someone then is prepared to go through all those documents in order to even make that exercise.
So yeah, I guess I'll clarify what I'm seeing, and it's a difference in understanding between the department and people who have tracked implementation of things. Asking someone is going to give us more self-report data that has more validity. So I want to be very clear that I just raised a huge question of all the existing data y'all collect. It has no integrity. So no, I'm not asking y'all to do a survey of schools. I'm asking if, and what I'm hearing back, I want to clarify and make sure I'm understanding. What I'm hearing back is the department is basically saying it has no idea the level of implementation of school model master discipline plans in the state.
You're making a lot of statements that are your personal opinion about the quality of the work that we do and what we do. But that said, to dedicate basically a full-time person, and this is going to be all they do, possibly for months, to go through every school system's discipline policies and make a judgment call as to whether or not we think that they are implementing it consistent with what the law required that they adopted on October 1st, 2004. Now, the law does not require, it is silent as to what school systems are required to do after October 1st, 2004. So would it be your expectation with this motion that we dedicate someone on our staff or more than one person to go out and review possibly over 100 school systems policies, and look, you mentioned data as well, look at their data, and make what kind of judgment call? Are they doing the thing that the law required them to do on October 1st, 2004? Is that
the expectation? Ms. Bentley, I see where you're going, and so that we don't make something unreasonable.
I'll be honest in just letting you know that, one, I don't know that we have the capacity of a staff person to do that. That is a lot of work. And number two, what exactly would that person be looking for? Because the law only says each city, parish, or other local public school board shall cause to be developed and shall submit by October 1st, 2004 a master plan for each school under the board's jurisdiction for improving behavior and discipline in each school based on the model master discipline plan developed and approved by BESSE, which BESSE did. BESSE fulfilled that requirement also in 2004. So is that the standard to which we would review what they have right now to say, is it consistent with what they adopted in 2004? And if that is not the expectation, would we be reviewing it again?
I'm not trying to be argumentative. I'm looking at the statute, and there are sections that's not true about March 1, 2004. It says further on in the law, the model master plan for master plans required of city, parish, local school board, school boards by this section. It's not, it's saying it's required.
So there's an assumption built in that they are continuing to do this in some form or fashion.
Yes. I'm not an attorney. I don't want to get caught in saying something that I may not be right about. So that's why I'm being very polite. I asked the gentleman, and he gave me some guidance, and he may be wrong because it's every lawyer doesn't agree with every lawyer. But he's saying, and I take it, I'm just operating, giving Mr. Garrett the benefit of very little doubt on my part, that he's right. The guidance doesn't mean, it's not directed. But over here, the word required, I'm not going to ask him what required means. Required, it says, that the model master plan for approving the neighborhood district of the schools and school master plans required of city, parish, and local public school boards by this section. I think there's not a chance that someone had an intent, go create something and never use it again after March 4, 2004, just create it. I think it's understood that if someone is creating something, it's something to be used. And if there's not another law on the books that contradicts this requirement, then the requirement exists. Now that they should have some type of master discipline plan. Now, Bessie was required to develop one. Bessie did. It exists. I can email you a copy, but I'm sure you already have it. And up here, this body here, according to what I'm reading, is not required to do the work of looking at anything. It requires us to provide you best practices in providing support to public school governing authorities. So we are tasked only with coming up with what we define as best practices, and not to do the oversight and all of the laborious work in looking at each individual master plan involving like 1,452 schools the last time I was here. And then later on, we have another job. Once we've given you what best practices are, it gives us another job to figure out a way, working with you, providing guidance, as to how we can verify that happened. Down at the bottom, and write a report.
And what I'm saying is, we're happy to do the survey. I just want to be very clear about what we're asking districts to give us, and then what we do with that information when we get it, because the law is silent as to whether or not a school system has the ability to amend their model master discipline plan that's being developed locally from thereafter. It is, I would assume that most school systems have made changes since 2004.
They've probably made quite a bit.
All I'm saying is I don't know what standard we would review them against.
This topic has come up before in this council early on when it was first created.
Oh, sure.
And what the department shared with this council is that 252 references a finite time period of 2004.
Yeah, it does not. Actually, I says to provide for better and more useful reporting on an annual basis of school behavior in the district with an entire law.
Okay, so Gina, where are you reading from?
It's right on
A1.
It's the document.
252A.
It's 2.
But that falls under the same timeline as to, like, it's telling Bessie to develop basically a model.
Yeah.
And that model shall consist of
I would like to ask Danny a question because I think Danny is best at this. And Danny, here's my question. When I'm reading 17252, I go to the bottom of the page. And the bottom of the page has acts that were passed. The first act was 1225 of 2003 that created it. Then there were acts in 2009, 2010, and 2016. And those acts required, in my opinion, school systems to add things to their model master discipline plan to specify elements that they had to respond to. So to me, the legislative intent is it continues, but that's
right.
My question.
Well, I mean, I can answer it. And this will paint it to some extent. If you read the, and you can't read a sentence, you've got to read the entire statute together. The little I is actually in subsection A, paragraph 2. That starts with the model master plan, and this is in reference to the model master plan adopted by Bessie. May include, but need not be limited to, guidelines for accomplishing the following, and a colon, and then there's A through I. So those are things that Bessie made, but was not required to put in its model master plan.
That we gave?
That they then adopted and sent out to everybody.
Right.
Then, each school district was required to adopt a master discipline plan for their school district. And there was one limitation placed upon school districts that their master plan, quote, shall not prohibit a teacher from removing a pupil from the classroom for disciplinary reasons in accordance with the provisions of RS 17416. They were then required to send those master plans back in 04 to the department. Ostensibly, I guess the only thing y'all did was collect them and make sure they didn't violate that one prohibition. Nothing said that the master plan adopted by the local school district had to be identical to the model, because again, it's a model, nor did it have to include A through I, because A through I were what was an illustrative, non-restrictive list of what could have been in their model plan. So, in other words, and again, this talks about for reporting on an annual basis, which goes, I think, to Sean's thing about the data, that yes, the state's model plan could have recommended this reporting. Now, there are other laws that mandate reporting on discipline issues that are not actually governed by this. But that's the way this law is structured. There was a one-time creation of a model, a one-time obligation for school districts and charter schools that existed at the time, because that's the interesting thing, is you have charter schools that didn't exist in 2004, they could not have complied with this, to then adopt their own master discipline plan and submit it to the department. Now, every school district, every charter school still has a student code of conduct that they utilize to implement what supersedes the model discipline plan, which is the state discipline law.
Mr. Garrett, let me ask you a question. When this statute, 253, it follows up, we have a 253 now. Okay, so I hear what you're saying, and by the way, I do acknowledge Mr. Garrett's interpretation. I agree with him. Now, others may not, but I do see what he's saying. I do see what he's saying here. However, I have a question now, a legal question. When we look at 253 at the bottom under G, it says, with respect to the implementation of school master plans for improving student behavior and discipline, as provided in revised statute 17:252. My question for you would be, sir, even though 252 may not have any more application other than back then, it is citing the verbiage of that law and saying the master plan that I'm talking about as the one that was provided in revised statute 252. So if it says, as provided by that law, this somebody here is saying, what I need you to do is what those guys wrote up and what they required then. That's how I interpret letter G.
And again, with regard, and it talks about the implementation, not the adoption. There was an adoption of master plans as mandated back in 2004. As I appreciate this.
So if I'm saying with respect to the implementation.
The implementation.
Of that plan.
So in other words, if a school district's code of discipline was not violated its own master plan, for example. That's whether or not the master plan is being implemented.
Right.
Adoption is one thing, implementation is something else. Adoption was a mandated adoption took place back in 2004.
And that was my concern.
And that was
that
the one.
If we were to go back and collect all of these discipline policies now, would we be reviewing them to be able to come back and tell you they are implementing exactly what was adopted in 2004? Because I suspect 2004 was a long time ago. I would suspect that many school systems have made changes since then. Based on the request of their own communities, teachers, and parents, we have no idea
how
those things might have changed over the past 15 years.
And also, G is not the department board. It says the advisory council shall annually submit a report to the Senate Committee on Education, to the House Committee on Education, and the State Board of Elementary and Secondary Education regarding its, that's our council's, findings and recommendations with respect to the implementation of school master plans for improving student behavior and discipline. So in a sense, it would be this council's job to go do the research to find out if districts are adhering to their own master plans and to report that to BESSE, not for BESSE to go make that determination and report it to us. Now, I believe we could request that the department assist us in that task of making that determination so that we can write that report.
And that's why I said we're happy to do that, because I mean, we have structures in place to do that. We have a newsletter that goes out every week. We frequently survey districts on different things that have been requested. We're happy to go and make this request to say, we have this advisory council, they have requested to see a copy of all of your discipline plans. Can you please email them to us? We can compile those and give them back to you. But if you're asking us then to take another step of doing a deep dive analysis into over 100 school systems discipline policies, one, I'm going to be very honest with you, we are half the size that we were several years ago as an agency. We simply do not have the staff capacity to do that. And number two, I am uncertain, I am unclear as to what's the standard by which we would measure those things against. Are we comparing them to the model master plan that was adopted in 2004? I think that might be out of date in a number of school systems that have updated their policies since then. And if that's not the standard, what is the standard?
And again, and I don't know if the evaluation is necessarily whether an individual district's plan, master plan, line for line corresponds to the model.
Because it was intended to be
a model. It's whether, as I appreciate it, it's whether or not the districts and the charter schools have been implementing their own master plan.
Right.
In other words, is their master plan just a document sitting on a shelf somewhere that never gets referred to and does not guide discipline in the district? Or is their student code of conduct in line with the master plan that they adopted back in 2004?
And each of those may look different.
And each of them will look different.
Mr. Garrett, I think Ms. Bentley is correct. When you look at the provisions of A, 2, and I, and Representative Womack was saying, I'm willing to agree that the May gives them tremendous latitude as to what it looks like up in that section of 252. But then when you go down further in the other subparagraphs, it is clear that the intent is ongoing. And I think if you go down to these other subparagraphs, some of this, it's clear it's ongoing. It says, city, parish, and other local school boards shall provide ongoing classroom and courses and regular review of disability from each school to determine, and so on, so on. Most districts or schools, by necessity, are doing that. I can testify for God and man, that we all wish we were not doing it, but we have to do it if we're going to be successful in the classroom and in our schoolhouse. So I would say we will, Mr. Henry, it's all about you, sir. You were asking what was the reason for us being here, and we're fleshing it out as we speak, sir. And I would say that we will be providing best practices as we can define them under paragraph A, and we'll figure out in A and G. This is A and G. We can think and brainstorm with all of the human resources in the room. We can figure out what will be some best practices that they can do, and we can advise them and provide some guidance. And then I know what guidance means, Mr. Garrett. According to you, we can provide some guidance and see where it gets us, as well as at the end of the day, we can submit a report on what they did based on our guidance. And it's some interesting, good work. Yes?
So, I've got a little lost, I apologize. Do we have a motion on the floor? Do we
get a second?
No second, yeah.
There is no second. Should we ask for a second?
I'll second the 416 motion.
No.
The chairman knows where we are. That passed unanimously.
All right. So, where are we at?
We would just, I can be concise, sir, which is unique for me. We have determined that Mr. Henry's concern is now no longer concerned. It is.
My concern about Frost, about role is moved. It's been satisfied. I think
we have a purpose is to address A and G. Figure out what we can do to assist the department and give them some ideas about best practices. And then G, at the end, we're going to write a report based on what we make recommendations. If they don't follow any of them, we just make a report on what guidance we provided.
Sure.
And how useful we were.
And the only thing I'll add, and I'll come out all the time, is we keep referencing the Act 2018, number 600, sections 1 and section 2, regarding certain review and reporting requirements of this council. I looked it up, I can't find it on my phone. I have to look on my laptop when I get to the office.
You have that, Mr. Fleming?
I don't need it now. I'm just going to, as we move forward, I just want to familiarize myself because we keep referring to G, but I think it sounds like section 1 and 2 of Act 2018-600 gives us more reporting requirements that I'll familiarize myself with.
So, once again.
No, Mr. Coulter, I think the difference is that earlier you were pushing us to where we were going. I'm saying, to me, that's what we're only trying to define what the purpose was. We don't need a motion for that. We just wanted to get to understanding that was the work of the some reason people were confused about what the work with this meant. I think
we have a motion that Mr. Fleming offered. I don't think we have a second, and so I'm not
sure. Mr. Fleming, repeat your motion, sir.
The motion is to request that the Department of Education provide a status update on the implementation of school model master district plan statewide.
Do we have a second?
No,
sir, we do not.
Thank you.
However, in letter A, at some point, Mr. Fleming, we may be coming back and somebody may give you a second. Once we figure out what that best practice might be as to how that might be best achieved, we may certainly be revisiting your failed lack of a second. So do not be disheartened, sir. You know, Rome wasn't built in a day. Yes.
I feel like the conversation has been telling in that the department's interpretation of this is that they promulgated a master plan in 2001, and the districts were supposed to come up with master plans. It seems like it's been, what I'm hearing, untouched since 2004. So is what you are now saying what we can do is with that information decide if there is it a best practice to say let's return to improving the department's master plan and say there needs to be more oversight of that plan, right? So maybe we can clarify and limit the question and say, if you don't have this information independently, then tell us that, and because that's essentially what I'm hearing is nobody's done anything since 2004 publication of the master plan.
So I think, so Mr. Fleming, you just want the department, sir, to survey whether each school in each district, including charters, every defined district which includes charters, has a model master plan of discipline? Is that what you want, yes or no? Is that the survey you want, sir?
Sorry, I thought we had moved on. Can we finish with what I was saying?
Sure.
Okay, so what I am asking is, if they don't have that information without a survey, that tells this group something that can guide us, right?
And I will agree with you because the law does not require, did not require,
well,
and still
have
does not require, if I can
finish
too, the law does not require that we annually monitor districts and how they implement discipline. The law was very And I, as I have been told, the legislature did not want that to be the role of the state. The legislature wanted school districts to implement their own policies based on the model that our board provided, but then specifically told districts, you go forth and adopt your own policies, and intentionally did not say that the state is going to be, you know, looking to see how you're doing it at the local level. I think that was done intentionally, where the legislature said, we think these things are best implemented closest to schools and kids. If the legislature had wanted the department to provide ongoing oversight, they would have told us to do that, but they did not. And so I just wanted to make it clear, this is not a situation where the department has not done something that they were required to do.
Yeah, I don't think that
they were not required to do that. Now, what I'm telling you is that information is needed or being sought by this group. We're happy to go and assist you in getting that information, but in terms of analyzing that and making judgment calls, I'm reluctant for us to take that on. One, because I have concerns about our capacity to do that. Two, I don't know that the way we would review them to tell you if they're doing, quote, a good job implementing them or not, you may disagree with what constitutes good. Because all of that's going to be pursuant to that local school system's policy, which they have the legal ability to decide what's in their local policy.
So we had a lack of a second with respect to Mr. Fleming's motion, so it fails for lack of a second. Does anybody have an objection to moving on the agenda at this time? Yes, sir, Mr. Gordon.
Go back to the basics, and I might need some help. Okay. At one time, from the State Department of Education, we got a form on the master of this one.
Attempt.
That's correct. I think you was involved with that.
I was, sir.
Mr. Chatton. Okay. I got a revised one maybe a year ago from the state. Because there's no longer no child left behind.
You gotta speak a lot about
it. I'm looking at all the items. We all received guidance from the Department of Education. It was a format that we used and we gave it to all the schools. And they would check off and answer questions and submit it to the central office. And then towards the second half of it, towards the end of the year, we had a second section where we had a committee meeting reviewing our student code of conduct and all the data of what took place in discipline that year. And then we made recommendations at the district level on how to tweak our student code of conduct and our policies. Okay. So my question would be, we don't want to start, we want to look at this and understand this master plan. Maybe we need a copy of this template so that everybody can understand what we're talking about.
Yes, we can provide that real quick if it's online.
Right.
I would request, though, Ms. French, do we have a room with a Promethean board and computers and stuff like that in future meetings possible?
We can try to reserve one. I don't know, is there one at the Promethean board?
So, can I make a motion to request a copy?
We'll try to find something at least the board can write on.
Can I ask for a copy of that template that we use from the master discipline?
The one, which one?
The last one you gave us.
The one that was adopted in 04? That's the only official one. Now, our staff, it could have been, not that it was required, but our staff could have just given guidance to districts along the way, but again, that was just guidance, it was just a model.
I think y'all tweaked it and sent it out again.
Okay, I'm happy to check with our staff and find the most recent version of guidance that went out.
So we can start off with something, so that I can see the template, how we tackled the master district plan at the school level.
And your chair says that he has the copy, the official copy from before that can be provided, but...
As I look at this, it looks to me like this is a pretty comprehensive copy and paste of the provisions of the Bessemer Master Plan that's right here, made a part of the agenda. It looks pretty close to what the schools had to provide.
That's not what I'm talking about exactly. There's a template that we checked off.
Yeah, he's talking about the one with the boxes on the left.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I'm only saying this is a summary of what was required.
This is a summary.
So it's pretty exhaustive.
Do I have to make a motion for this, or can
you? You just have to ask me, Brad. I'll send you whatever you might need.
Well, I
sent it to everybody. I have everybody's email now. They got mine too. All right.
Okay, so.
So, I think. So, but I hate to like sound like I'm echoing, but I really want to applaud Mr. Henry for keeping us on focus. I think. No, sir. The reason why we're here is the most important thing, because if we don't have any confidence in that, we may not see you again. Because if you don't want to come somewhere and do nothing, I know I don't, sir. Because me, I had to leave 435 students to come here to be here. And I am I'm a hard worker. It's very painful for me to come. I'm only coming because I was drafted. And I praise the Lord that I was, but it's bittersweet in a way I wish I wouldn't have been. You know, it's a bittersweet for me today because I love my students. And so I think the next, let me ask, it'd be the pleasure of the group. Are we going to tackle now today and try now to define what are some best practices? I heard you said one thing. We might want to look at the Bessemer Master Plan as a template, the checklist, the whole nine yards. And then from there, we got psychologists and so on in this room, figure out what are some best practices we might want to recommend to the Louisiana Department of Education, the State Board of Elementary and Secondary Education, some best practices that we might want to see fleshed out in classrooms and in schoolhouses across the state. Because that's what A says, providing advice and guidance. And then also we can decide, because that gives us focus if we know exactly, figure out what the practices are, and then we've got to figure out how we're going to report it out. Sounds like a plan. Absolutely. So we have some focus. We have some work, Mr. Henry. We have purpose. Please bring some best practices with you the next time that you come, sir.
I will bring some perspective from parents that we work with directly.
Yes, sir.
You'll have some information.
Yes, sir. Thank you for that. And that also applies to everybody here, including me. I promise you, I'll be coming. I'll be loaded for bear when Mr. Schaff comes, because I did some of this work 5 years with some of the people in the room, and I will be prepared to share with you what I would like to see as best practices involving disciplining children.
And I just wanted to add, just further clarify, Mr. Henry, you know, a more holistic look at why we're here. As we talked about a little bit earlier in regards to like this is a product of the Juvenile Justice Reform Act. basically, this is an education juvenile justice partnership act. And a lot of this, we're mainly here because back in the day, we had so many children being suspended and expelled from schools, and they were ending up in prison. So to work and ensure that young people were given the best opportunity to remain in school, this is why I'm here. The mastermind plan is a part of that. Like, how are we going to increase and make sure that we're using conflict resolution process and getting support and all of those pieces that's going to actually provide for a greater opportunity to reduce suspensions and expulsions. So I also just wanted to kind of add that part to it, because sometimes we're lucky. We pick up and we move, but the whole intent of why we're doing what we're doing, well, I just wanted to add that in as well.
Yes, I appreciate that. The only thing I'll add on is that the work we do typically is around equity, so looking at both sides of policy is one thing, implementation is one thing, and then you look at the outcomes in terms of, I think that's the important part of the data. Is it being enforced from an equitable and fair standpoint? Is there one subset of demographic of students that it just looks like it's maybe unfairly implemented? If that's the case, I would expect our purpose of being on here is to look at those inequities if they exist and how we can make them more fair.
Right, well, you know, the department could speak to that quite well. Federal government provides ad nauseum specificity as to disproportionality and what it means and what the districts have to do about it. I was painfully involved in that work here, making sure that we identify who is disproportionate, and we work with those districts providing supports and training, PBIS, trying to reduce disproportionality in overrepresentation of suspension and expulsion data for minorities. So I do know what you are talking about, and that is a concern of mine.
And sped students. I mean, we do a lot of work with sped students.
Well, the number one concern they had was disproportionality of special ed students, disabled students, but also minorities. Yes.
Back when we first started, I guess it was maybe not the first time, sorry, the first time I got onto this committee a couple of years ago, we did a lot of things as far as like different ideas, as far as what are some best practices and things like that, which are all great. I'd love to hear some of the things that some of the that people have to say. But to put that into like some type of like policy or recommendation that a school district does is probably not going to happen as far as like, hey, you need to do this type of thing. Hey, here's some ideas maybe, but for somebody to do it. Sean had last year worked on, maybe worked on a good word, but really emphasized the Department of Education, like provide the PBIS model, or you know, what are their plans for discipline? So that way, we as a committee could look at them and make recommendations on those things. Like, what is the department already doing, or what are their plans to give to the committee, so that way we can say, hey, look, we may want to beef this portion of it up, or make sure that that you know we have fidelity measures, etc. And I don't think we ever got to that, or never got that information. Never went that way with it. It's always been kind of, besides the legislation, it's always been kind of, well, here's some best practices, which is, once again, great, but it doesn't, to me, it doesn't go into any action for anything. It's just something, hey, here's some stuff to go do. Nobody's going to actually do it, because I say nobody's going to do it. It's going to take a school district to say, hey, I want this, I'm going to need to get some more education on it, but it's not going to be something that's going to be massive.
Yeah.
Ask why across the state.
Yeah, in response to Michael's statement and the reference to the discussion coming to the table of this council, the previous Department of Education staff person, Katie Barros, who sat on this council, did present to this group the work of the Department of Education addressing those schools that have been identified with excessive out-of-school suspension. And we shared our strategies well as resources that they would have access to implement to try to address those excessive out-of-school suspensions. So we can definitely provide an update to this council at the next meeting, but we did share that information.
And I think one of the things we certainly could do, I'm glad you made your comments, sir, the department is not in the same place, neither is the state of Louisiana today as it was when we lost 150 people in the building. You know, there's a surplus right now, a very large surplus. When I came to the department, there was a PBIS coordinator at the department, and they had over $1 million grant that was through LSU to roll out PBIS trainings throughout the entire state. As I alluded to earlier, there were 8 PBIS consortiums. I had a suitcase, and there were hotels, and they gave me a rental car down the street, and I went all over the state, and we were doing some things, some good things in training. LSU had a team of people that was training throughout the state. We came on hard times in Louisiana, and they had to make tough decisions, the state and this department. Well, times are better now, so one of the recommendations we might make would be to maybe consider hiring people in the Louisiana Department of Education to do some of the work that Ms. Manley said she doesn't have the people to do, to create a positive behavior prevention supports section. Again, in I'm not sure what that office is called now, it's been a few years, but whatever the Office of Community and Support is called now, if it's not the same thing, could put somebody in there or some people to work and help provide trainings. I think, yeah, we still have consortiums in the local districts.
We do. Yes, we do. Yep, and we still provide them with annual funding, which supports their prioritization and offering of trainings. So there are trainings that each consortium provides their members, and so there are 8 consortiums that still get funding on an annual basis.
And if I could maybe add to that, we are trying to take what little money we have now and push it out as much as we can to have the most impact at the local level. Unfortunately, that funding has not really resulted in us being able to add capacity at the state level in terms of state employees. And actually, Leslie just brought up a good reminder to me. While overall, the economic condition of the state is better than it has been in the past years, past a few years, our agency took a cut even this last session, almost $1 million. So every year for the past several years, we have had significant budget cuts. So, you know, all that to say, what resources we do have, we are trying to push those down as much as possible to deliver assistance and support to the locals in implementing their plans in accordance with state law. Unfortunately, we just have to be honest with you about our capacity of individuals at the department who can do a lot of this work that we would like to do, but we have really had to trim our staff functions down to the bone as to what is legally required because we can't get out of that stuff. So.
And who knows, maybe we'll talk to our champion for the revision of 17-4-6. Maybe we can get him a champion some increasing your budget for PBIS. That would be something we could always ask him to get a bill, a funding bill.
I'd like to break. It's 12:40.
All right, let's take a break.
And have a lunch break. Maybe 15, 20 minutes. And then come back.
Always finish at 1. We're done at 1.
We're done.
Well,
we're done?
Yes.
Exactly.
It's
too late.
The last meeting lasted until 2. I didn't see any time.
Right, because
I was assuming it was 2 because I only had the old agenda. I read it and I saw y'all adjourned at 2. So I made an assumption it was 2.
Well, I did 10 to 1 because we just didn't have a lot on it. So.
But that would be the case, we won't be taking a break. We'll be adjourning in 10 minutes.
Ms. French has a presentation.
Ms. French, can you do your presentation? Reader's Digest version, condensed?
I'll do it. No,
all right, thank you.
Did Dr. Colter have a question?
I was just lost on where we were on the agenda, but it sounds like we're now on number five.
Yes.
Got it.
Like
thank you.
Yep. So at the last meeting, the request came for the Department of Education to provide information on the identification of struggling schools that have been labeled urgent intervention required for discipline. And so in your folder, you have a slide presentation, a two-sided document, four slides. And this gives you some context as to how these schools were identified with the label of urgent intervention required. Our ESSA plan allows us to identify struggling schools in several different categories. One category that I think is of interest to this council is that category for discipline. And so if you look at the second slide on the front page, there is a table that indicates there are four labels right now that can be applied to a struggling school. One label is comprehensive intervention required, and those are schools that have been identified because they have a D or F letter grade, their school performance score, for three consecutive years, or they have a graduation rate that is less than 67% in their most recent year. The next label for a struggling school is urgent intervention required by a student group. We have several student groups. They include groups by race, students with disabilities, English learners. And so those schools have been identified because those groups, their group score is equivalent to an F letter grade for two consecutive years. That third label is the label of interest to this group, which is urgent intervention required for discipline. These are schools that have been identified because they have an excessive out-of-school suspension rate that is defined as two times the national average for three consecutive years. That would be greater than 5.2% for pre-K through four and greater than 20.2% for grades 5 through 12.
What were those numbers again?
Yep, it's actually on the next slide, slide three. Yep, but it is greater than 5.2% for pre-K through four and greater than 20.2% for grades 5 through 12. Now, I will share with you that from our comprehensive list of well over 400 schools identified as struggling because they have one of these four labels, approximately 175 of those schools were identified with the label of urgent intervention required for discipline. But of that group of 175, they also had an academic label. Because they had two labels, we as an agency prioritized them focusing in this current academic year of 1920 on strategies and implementation of those strategies for their academic label. Therefore, when you filter out those schools from the 175 that had two labels, there remain 44 schools that had one label being an urgent intervention required for discipline label. Those schools were required to submit to the Department of Education a plan that they submitted in June and to define in that plan how they would address their excessive out-of-school suspension. I will share with you, we gave them clear guidance that the plan was not to just say we were going to provide training. The plan was to first and foremost do a needs assessment of all stakeholders, do an analysis of your data so that you could get to the root cause of the problem. The outcome of the problem is your excessive out-of-school suspension. That is not the problem. The problem is at a deeper root, and so therefore the plan needed to include, one, the school identifying a vendor that they would work with. Those vendors have been identified based on their national, local, and state experience and expertise in supporting schools and our school systems in developing large-scale, comprehensive, coherent behavior systems. Once they identify that vendor, they work with the vendor to do a needs assessment, to analyze their data, identify the root causes, then come up with their implementation plan, which identifies a vision, some clear goals, some responsibility and accountability for staff. They are to identify a school support team and a leader of that team who will have responsibility for leading this work, which we don't call behavior intervention. We call it student engagement and success. As an agency, we believe that the core of a lot of what we see in the area of behavior and discipline is due to a lack of engagement, along with a lack of appropriate resources and strategies, and supports and services that are provided to our students that we need, we know need more intensive support, such as mental health services. And so those 44 schools submitted a plan to the department. The department reviewed those plans. Upon our review, we made recommendations that went to BESSE last month in August to award those plan funds. I will back up and say that as an agency, we gave to those school systems with the UIRP schools an initial planning grant for them to work with the vendor that they identified. The funds for the planning grant were to be used to support the completion of that needs assessment and the analysis of the data. We then came and gave them incremental funding in August to support the implementation of their plan. Our priorities as an agency in this current academic year is to go out and do some observations in those schools that received money, engage those vendors on a regular reoccurring basis to stay aware of their progress of support of our schools. But again, this year we want to go out in our schools, observe what is happening in terms of implementation progress of that plan. I will stop. I've said a lot to see if there are questions.
Just a couple questions. One, I have really brief. You referenced the national average. What's the source?
I can send you all the link, but it's basically data from the Office of Civil Rights. It's the data that the U.S. Department of Education collects, but I can send you the link.
And then you referenced the 44 schools.
Yes.
That's out of how many? Like total, is that out of all the schools in the state of Louisiana?
So out of all the schools in the state of Louisiana, there were close to 444 schools identified as struggling, meaning they have one of these four labels. Out of that 400 plus, there were 176 that had an urgent intervention required for discipline label. From the 176, there were 44 who only had the UIRD label. Those are the 44 that we have identified as a priority.
Well, I'm just trying to get a notion of the scope of the issue. Yeah. So that's 44 out of how many?
Out of the
500, 700, how many schools?
Oh, out of the
14.
Yeah, out of the.
So it's out of the 1,400?
Yeah, approximately.
And that's what I asked, I just want to make sure. Because that 44 would include everything from elementary, middle, and high.
Correct.
Correct. So out of the 1,400 schools, there were 44 that had that.
And yeah. Let me just put an emphasis on that because I see you're kind of measuring scale. The 44 just represents those schools who only had one label.
Right.
But there were more schools that have a discipline problem.
Now, the percentages for that, like the exceeds two times the national average, was that set by statute or by BESSE?
That was a part of our ESSA plan.
And I guess finally, you mentioned vendors. Are school districts required to engage a vendor? Or could they have a plan that they develop themselves internally?
So it is not required for school systems to engage a vendor. Engagement with a vendor does provide eligibility for competitive funds because our agency has vetted all of those vendors that are accessible.
So,
but school systems can choose to go with no vendor at all or another vendor that is not in our vendor guide, because they have the discretion to use local funds to apply towards this work and not just the competitive funds that we make available.
And is there, again, the requirement that they only can access the funding if they use a discrete list of vendors, is that part of the ESSA plan? Is that BESSE rule? Is that statute?
That's a part of the ESSA plan.
you send us those statistics in an email? Would you just...
Can I ask a question? Yeah, have you looked at their discipline plans? Those 44 schools, have you looked at those plans? Do we know if they're following our master plan, the state's master plan? I mean, what are those expulsions, those failures based on? I know the data, but what are they doing that is causing that problem? That, you know, you've got to go back to the source of the problem.
Yep.
So how are we looking at that?
That is what I explained that we're looking at this year. In addition to the plan that they submitted to us in terms of how they are going to address the discipline. So we are taking that plan out when we go to actually observe and see what they're doing in terms of implementing.
Yes,
yeah, that's what I shared. We're going to all of those 44 schools. Yeah, no problem.
So the last item on the agenda, I have 1.5 minutes. It says discussion on the council's priorities going forward and reiterating for the 7th time at least. We identified that the homework was that people in the room will figure out what are some best practices that we could be making, providing advice and guidance to the Louisiana Department of Education and BESSE as far as what they could do with regard to implementation of Louisiana Revised Statute 17:252, bring that to the next meeting. That is Mr. Coulter. That is the last item on the agenda, and it is clear. Please, sir, you have a wealth of lifelong experience in this. Please prepare to come give us some feedback what we can do, everybody else included, to provide some guidance to BESSE and LDOE. Yeah, anybody have? Yes, sir.
253 says we are required to meet at least 3 times annually. We've met as of today twice. So is there a plan that we're going to meet again this calendar year?
That's at a minimum number, right, sir?
That's correct.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, there is. I thought there was some information I received that there was a date set on the look forth.
The next meeting was scheduled for December 6th.
Yes, there was a date set December 6th. The day before Pearl Harbor Day, folks, we will meet again. And can we make that meeting 10 to 2? And we can have a little breaking of bread in between, as Mr. Crudo would have liked. My esteemed colleagues. It's been an absolute shocking pleasure to come together and really, I know we didn't get that much done, but I think we got a lot more done than you think when we come back together next time. When people bring, I know Mr. Ortega, he will be bringing something. I heard what you said. You may come back to the table with your idea. The LDOE can provide us already feedback of what they're already doing. And we can critique from what they're doing. Right? Yes, sir.
We've
got to
submit. This organization has to submit a plan for the legislative session by February. And if that's going to be your third meeting and you're only going to meet 3 times, you better be ready for some legislative
decision.
You better be ready if you're going to promote what we already adopted. And
that's the minimum number of meetings, sir.
For the next meeting,
we'll set up our meetings as we need them when we come in December, on the 6th. We plan on all meeting on the 6th. Thank all y'all so much for your support for our students in Louisiana. Second, Mr. Ortega, anyone does not want to adjourn at this time, it is unanimous.